just all this recently about thinking about giving up. And so just listen to this.
Oh, yeah, because y'all have a testimony. What, year two now?
Probably.
Yeah. Y'all grow up real fast. So I ended up having a relapse about 8 months ago. And I got real, real, real depressed again because, I was in the Lord for quite a few years and living right. And I ended up relapsing, and I got fired. Actually, Pastor Eric called me about a month ago and told me I was supposed to be at the revival. And I was like, nah, man, I'm working 70 hours a week. I'm working my way up in this corporate company. I'm going to be an owner. I'm going to make $100,000 a year. Like, it's always money. Money always kills me. Every time. And so I was like, thanks, Pastor Eric, but, I got to work. And I was seeing somebody, and so I got dumped by him, and then I got fired, and I got real depressed, and I had been using again, and I was like, all right, God, I don't know what you want me to do. I'm stuck again, and I got real suicidal and depressed, and I texted Kendra and told Kendra I was going to come to the revival, and then I tried to back out, and then Adam invited me to the meeting over
behind
Westtown Mall. And, like, I pulled in and out of the driveway, like, three times to go to this meeting, and I was like, I'll wait till it's over, and then I'll go in and I'll talk to Adam, because Adam knows what's up wrong with me. I finally go in, and I was like, cool, he's talking to somebody. Maybe I can just come in here and then leave, and he won't notice very much. But a guy had stopped me and started sharing his testimony with me about being delivered from drugs, too. And I was like, dang, I'm stuck. And Adam walked up and was like, we have an extra seat. Somebody canceled in the van for us. So you have a seat if you want to go still. And I was like, no, man, I got six job interviews lined up, managing restaurants and this and that. And I was like, all right, because I was like, I got like $1,200 worth of bills I got to pay. I haven't worked in three or four weeks, and, this is a problem. And he's like, well, what would you need to go? And I was like, well, I need help with my bills. And he's like, cool, God just, bless me and bless you. And I was like, all right, well, I'll go home and pack, and then I'll meet you guys at the house. So I got to my house, and I was like, I ain't going. This ain't happening. So my roommate comes in, and she's like, well, what reason do you not have enough to go? And I was like, well, I got to pay my bills. And she's like, didn't you just say your friends were going to help you with your bills? And I was like, yeah. And she's like, pack your stuff right now. You're leaving. And my roommate pretty much kicked me out of my own house. So I got in the van and went to Iowa to the revival. And within 5 days, all of my bills got paid by other people. As I told God, I was like, all right, God, like, I don't have a job. I'm going to need you to be my sugar daddy right now because I can't do this. So within 5 days, all of my bills were paid. And I have $100 in my pocket. So, and I ain't got a job. And I've been doing ministry on the road for a week and a half now, sharing my testimony. And I got to go to an Indian reservation, which they don't normally let people into. I got to speak at a school. We had two cool classrooms with people. Little kids, 12, 13 years old, get saved, got healing, all kinds of cool stuff. And I'm fixing to go back up there and learn from Pastor Eric. I'm going to preach, and I'm not going to run from it anymore. But, Adam means, like, I wish I had a pastor in school as you guys do when I was your age, because I probably wouldn't have lived the life that I lived. And the stuff that he's teaching you, y'all need to take serious, because, like, the devil sneaks in, like, out of nowhere. I was clean for 4 years and relapsed. So, don't think.
I mean, the most important thing,
it don't matter.
I did everything.
You smoke weed?
Everything. I cooked meth. You're fine.
I didn't want to judge. I smoked weed like a pot.
No, you're fine. I smoked weed. I shot coke. I shot pills. I did meth.
So you say shot, you mean like
a needle? Like a needle, yeah. Like, it was bad.
Don't you like, just chop it up and you burn them from a spoon.
Hey, that's what don't matter,
man. All of that, yeah.
Always, yeah. I see it on her.
And I want to say this, it's not just y'all. Y'all are just what's here on Sunday. She used to be one that we were mentoring. And then she stopped. This process didn't have to happen if she would just stay true. And I'm saying this for anybody. It's no difference from me with Pastor Eric. If I stay true, That's my covering. I can always go to him when things get down and out, and I can talk to him. It's no different. But when I decide, oh, well, I don't really don't need that, and I stray, that's when things happen, and I have no covering, and it changes the nature of everything. I don't know why, but I was led to tell her to come up here and let y'all see, but she had to give up herself. When she went back home, and it was like, oh, you going to... Every drug, everything in our lives is the world saying, oh, you're going to lose all of it. Like, you ain't going to be having any more fun. All of it's going to come to a stop. And she's talking about having the most fun she's ever had in her life. She's talking about moving to a whole other state, which is honestly more beautiful than here. You know what I mean? And I'm just like, you know what? That's for the glory of God. God can use it. He's like, that's all I need is some bodies.
Somebody willing. It's like, I'm leaving everything. I'm leaving my house, my roommate, all my furniture. Everything I've rebuilt in the last 4 years, I'm leaving to her. I'm taking my clothes. I'm like, that's it. You guys can pay my bills in 5 days. You can pay them in however long I'm gone. So.
You know, listen, what do you want out of life? You know what I mean? Because I won't be here forever. I know God's going to move me out because I'm not called to stay here forever. I know I'm not. I wish I was because I was like, man, but I know there's more out there for me to go and do. And I hope you get it before that time runs out. You're like, man, I wish we would have. Because when I'm going somewhere else, who's going to be here to take over? I want this to keep going. I don't want it to leave. You know, Pastor Hurst got his testimony. He was somewhere God told him to go. He tried to build up the people to sustain on their own. And they didn't want to. It all fell apart. It didn't fall apart like, oh my gosh, they're forever doomed to know. But that didn't hold together because they didn't know how to keep it together. Y'all can keep it together outside of here as friends, but how do you keep it together in Christ out here? Doing it. So it's totally up to y'all. So I want you to just listen to this song and think about what God is doing for you. Are you willing to give that to him? Are you willing to give that to him? Because y'all are young. Get it now. Because when I'm preaching on Thursdays, they get it. You know what I used to say? Man, Thursday night, get it. I'll study for them, and then, you know what, I'll just give them the rest of whatever's left. And I'm just like, you know what, I'm going to treat y'all the same way I treat Thursday night. You know why? Because I'm more attached to y'all. I have a deeper relationship with a lot of y'all. That's why I get hurt so easily. And that comes with the shepherd's heart. So I want you to see that. Just give it to God. The world is going to spit you back out. But think about this. Just listen to the word of this song. And if, again, if you know it, sing it.
There's a voice that cries out in the silence, searching for a heart that will love. Longing for a child that will give him their all, give it all, he wants it all. And there's a God that walks over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate. And longing for a child that will give him their all, give it all, he wants it all. And he says, love me. Love me with your whole heart. He wants it all today. Serve me with your life now. He wants it all today. Bow down, let go of your idols. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all. There's a God that walks over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate. Longing for a child that will give him their all. Give it all. He wants it all. And he says, love me with your whole heart. He wants it all today. Serve me. Serve me with your life now. He wants it all today. Bow down, let go of your idols. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. You want it all today, so give it all. There's a voice that cries out in the silence, searching for a heart that will love him. Longing for a child that will give him their own gift. Oh, he wants it all.
Let's have a seat. Well, I gotta show them the video first. You know. Guys, we're gonna do something different this morning. You know, you guys have become the greatest guinea pig audience in the history of the world. And we broke ground on several sermons here over the years. And today we're going to break ground on another one. And before we do, I want to show you a little 6-minute video on something amazingly supernatural you've probably never seen before as far as in real life in your midst. But we're going to talk about supernatural teeth and a supernatural mouth this morning.
You see it?
Never expected the supernatural. God, he doesn't do things like this. This was not part of my way of thinking. This isn't something that I would even believe if someone had told me. We were in a desperate place in our marriage. Our marriage was very, very difficult, and it was full of hurt and disappointment. To a place where I didn't know if I even wanted to go on.
So when you went to the church, what happened?
Well, God did a miracle for us in that place.
And as she walked by me, I could smell that same sensation that you smell when you're in a dental office and they start drilling your teeth.
So, what was the miracle that happened to you?
God gave us gold teeth.
Hold on. Did you hear that?
God gave us gold teeth.
I should probably stop it here and explain a few things. You're probably wondering who these people are. Well, I can assure you, they aren't crazy. In fact, that's Aunt Patsy, and that's Uncle Bob. Now, I'm not the type of person who just believes everything he hears, but when your own family, who you've known your whole life and you know is on the up and up, tells you that, well, this happened to them in church, let's just say it makes you start to question a few things. So I began to wonder, well, if God put gold teeth in somebody's mouth, what else was he up to? I decided to travel the world to find out. And let me tell you, if you think this is weird, it's about to get a whole lot weirder. Everyone, no matter who you are or what you believe, has a kind of grid of understanding. Usually this grid is based on your experience or upbringing. My grid was pretty simple. God can do miracles if he wants to, but I never saw any, so, you know, they must be pretty rare. God was kind of like an invisible friend whose greatest hits happened a long time ago. Back then, people needed raw displays of power because their theology wasn't as, well, sophisticated as ours is now. There was one thing that I was pretty sure of. No matter what God did, he was very, very normal. And he always made perfect sense. Being new to all this miracle stuff, I figured the best place to start would be the one place that I knew best, church. So I started taking my camera to churches where I heard God was doing some, well, interesting things. I was already willing to accept the whole gold teeth thing because of my aunt and uncle, even though I still thought it was really stinking weird. But apparently, God wanted to make sure I got the point.
A disastrous situation. It's so, the dentists are so expensive, and I'm a senior, and I mean, I really needed some dental work, and he did it for me.
Wow. Hallelujah. Let me see that flashlight. He's got a flashlight. Let me see your flashlight real quick. Look at this. If you can see it, let's see. On the bottom, look at that.
It didn't take long for me to realize that gold teeth were just the tip of the iceberg. But even though so many people were getting these things, I couldn't shake that nagging question of why? Why teeth? Why would a God who's so normal do something so abnormal?
Well, certainly it's a sign and a wonder. And when it started happening here, I got in touch with unbelief that I didn't know I had. I said, why would God do this? This is kind of for them. You know, instead of people ask the question, if God's going to show up and do miracles, why doesn't he heal that lady in the wheelchair? Forget about gold teeth for somebody. And, you know, it's an unanswered question. I don't know why God does what he does sometimes. But I do know we had a lady in a wheelchair get a gold tooth one time, and she was very, very happy. She didn't say, I don't want this, I want my healing. She just was really honored and thrilled that God did that for her.
But it wasn't just gold teeth.
So, we're going to talk about how important your teeth, your mouth, your physical health is this morning. If you guys remember, we preached a message a few months ago entitled Spare
Angels, but even more than that, the Holy Spirit
and,
is the one who deals with them. And so
it wasn't any time at all before a need arose and someone in here had a baby who had a liver that wasn't fully formed. And because we had laid that groundwork for that message a week before, they had the faith to believe for that baby's liver to fully form, and that baby's alive today and doing well. So we're not just, this is not how can we entertain the kids today. This is not, oh gosh, what would be cute and different, you know, so they don't get too rowdy, let's do something off the wall. How can we hold their attention so they don't get too bored? Yeah, we'll talk about gold teeth. No, this is a thus saith the Lord, this is straight from heaven. I was supposed to preach this message 2 weeks ago, and I just got so totally exhausted I get it done. And so he's been on me heavy about doing this message, and so it worked out perfectly to do it this morning. And so, in fact, when the things started coming in about people needing teeth, just like a flock, my own teeth started hurting. I was like, and he's like, that's a sign to you that you need to get this message preached. You know, that's what they're feeling a little bit, so get this thing done. And so today we're going to go talk about this. Let me tell you why it's so important. The number two killer of Americans today is oral disease. Things in your mouth. It leads to heart attacks. It leads to, it's like tentacles. If your teeth aren't right, there's a lot of other things that are going to be wrong. Just some common dental problems that God wants to take care of today. And I heard the Holy Spirit say, tell them about their grandmother, their aunt. They've got relatives that are having teeth issues. They're my conduits. They're my missionaries to their families. That I'm going to anoint each one of them to go and lay hands on their relatives who have jacked up teeth and bad breath and all these different things. And I'm going to do signs and wonders and miracles among them. And so if you've got family that you know is dealing with these things, you're not just sitting in here for you. You're sitting in here for them. And maybe you're young and like, oh, I don't have any of those problems. Well, as you get older, you'll be glad you have the faith for this. You'll look back on this 40 years from now and go, whoa, 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 whoa. Is that a cavity? No, wait, I heard a message about healthy teeth, supernatural teeth. I'm not receiving that cavity. I'm receiving what the Word says. The children of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. 3 to 6 million people wandered in the desert. And not one of them in 40 years ever got sick, ever got a disease, ever got so much as a cold. 3 to 6 million people were totally kept by the power of God for 40 years. They didn't twist an ankle. They didn't have a knee injury. They didn't have a stubbed toe, plantar fasciitis, tendonitis. Nothing was wrong with them in 40 years. So don't act like, oh gosh, this is so hard, this is so impossible, oh, you know. No, this is what God does for people that allow it to have happen. And you have to have faith for it. How many of you, by show of hands, have ever looked in a mirror and said, man, I wish something about my teeth or my mouth or my smile was different? Raise your hand. That's you. Does that affect your self-esteem? It does. Does God care about your self-esteem? Absolutely. Does God want to grow you teeth and give you gold caps? And yeah, absolutely. He's just looking for somebody to show himself strong and mighty on their behalf, whose heart is fully loyal and trusting in him, trusting in his word. And we just happen to be off the wall enough to preach a message like this. Spare body parts and some of the other ones we've talked about, resurrection of the dead. I mean, what better place than right here where some people struggle to have dental insurance? Some people says, have you had your teeth whitening? What is that? Never heard of such a thing. You know, so there's the risk here of some of these things greater than maybe other places. So God's the great, we confiscated a gun one time here. He's the great Holy Ghost gun control. Okay, he's supernatural gun control. Well, he's also supernatural oral surgery. He's your supernatural dentist, if you'll let him be. He's your supernatural medical doctor, if you'll let him be. Some common dental problems. Number one, bad breath. I know nobody in here suffers from chronic bad breath. But if you did, if you knew somebody who did, you ever go to kiss somebody? And you're like, oh, hey, well, all right. Yeah, I got a Tic Tac. Here you go. Yeah, God cares about your breath. Do you know that in the book of Revelations, when Jesus splits the skies with his armies, the Bible says that he's going to slay his enemies with the breath of his mouth. They came to arrest Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Soldiers just jumped up on him. One of his closest companions betrayed him, brought these soldiers to him by night. Peter went to go cut a guy's ear off. But before that happened, Jesus asked them, who are you looking for? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. And he said, I am he. And when he said, I am he, every one of them fell to the ground backwards by the power of the breath of his mouth as a type of foreshadowing of what was coming in the book of Revelation in the last days. Your breath should be that powerful. You should have the fire of God coming out of your mouth. Mm-hmm. The breath coming out of your mouth should be like oil, should be like a fragrance from heaven. And people around you should just flock to hear your words. And if you're going to stand up and publicly talk to people, you're going to slay some people if you've got bad breath, but I don't think that's how the Bible talked about making it happen. The next one's tooth decay. Cavities. That's where sugar latches on to the juices in your mouth. And it's expensive to have that stuff taken care of. It's painful. And God doesn't want that for you. This is a side note. This is a natural thing. I've gotten into coconut oil. If any of y'all have coconut oil at home, you can take a tablespoon of coconut oil in your mouth and just 15, 20 minutes slosh it around. Okay? It's called oil pulling. And it pulls off the cavities. It pulls off the sugars and stuff on your teeth in a healthy way. Spit it out, brush your teeth. And you keep that up for a few months, and even in the natural cavities start disappearing and prevent new ones from coming. So even in the natural, it's possible. To do it supernaturally is not that big a deal, especially when so many of these things can be done in the natural now. It's just a matter of knowledge. Hosea 4:6, my people perish for a lack of knowing. Nobody probably ever told you could believe for clean white teeth, gold fillings. Awesome breath every day, never sick once. But you're being told today. And I know Pastor Adam teaches these things and preaches these things, so you'll hear it again and again and again. And everybody else around you may be sick and in bed because of the flu, and you'll be the only one up, quarantined by the power of the Holy Ghost. Everybody else may be falling off the wagon, but you're held in place by the faith in your heart and the word that's sown. There's periodontal disease. This is like a gum disease, and it's linked to heart attacks and strokes. People could die of a heart attack because they had gum disease? Absolutely. So how important is it to take care of your teeth? How important is it to have God watch over your mouth? Number four, oral cancer. And this is just having cancer of the mouth, lips or throat. Mouth sores. Anybody ever had a cold sore, stress, anxiety, and then boom, there that thing comes. You're not eating right, you're not sleeping right, your body's overtaxed, you're disobeying the law of rest and nutrition, and bam, you can't kiss your girl now, you don't want to look in the mirror, something all caked over like that, you're looking for this tube of something to cover it up, and then you're eating it, tastes all bad in your mouth. Yeah, God cares about that stuff. By the release of this word, he'll go into your heart and root out the things that are causing that thing to pop up like that. And then if you feel it coming back, you can lean back on this word and say, no, 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 no. I'm getting back on my word. No more cold sores. No more fever blisters. Tooth erosion. Anybody like chicken? I like chicken. Anybody like hamburgers and steak? I do. But you know, it's hard to enjoy those with no teeth, isn't it? You bite into something and a tooth break off because it's weakened. That doesn't have to be you. That doesn't have to be your grandma. It doesn't have to be your mom or your aunt or your dad or your uncle, your cousin, your brother, your dog, or your cat. Tooth sensitivity. It's like when you eat ice cream too fast. It's burning your teeth like that. But yet you didn't eat ice cream. It's just like that all the time. God cares about that. Toothaches. I was going to Duncan, South Carolina a few years ago, and one of the guys that was helping me run the church down there said, Pastor, do you have any announcements for Sunday morning service? And the Holy Ghost said, yeah, there's going to be somebody come that service with a toothache. Call it out. I want to heal it. I don't think that's the announcements he was looking for, but that was a Holy Ghost announcement. Now, that was on a Tuesday. A kid in the church on Thursday got a toothache. The word was given 2 days before the toothache came. And he shows up in church on Sunday, and the associate pastor is just kind of weirded out by the whole thing. So he reads it off a page. Pastor Eric said, the Lord said, somebody here had a toothache, and then this guy shoots his hand up. It's a sign and a wonder. God cares about the number of hairs on your head. I know he cares about the number of teeth in your mouth. An unattractive smile. That one's a little deeper. And that might be something physical or natural. You know, a cleft palate, something like that. But also, you know, the Bible says that an unhappy smile comes from a couple of different things. A merry heart maketh a cheerful countenance, but sorrow of heart is from a broken spirit. So some of you have mouth problems because your heart's broken. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. So some of this is not a physical thing. Some of this is in your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions. You've been disappointed so many times. It's affected your mouth. I've had a resurrection of my smile in the last 6-8 days. I've had a Holy Ghost move of God.
Amen.
You know, I'm finding a smile that I put in a suitcase somewhere a couple decades ago because God's just moving in my life. Well, that can be you. It don't have to be all frown city all the time. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
You got a why aren't you looking at your neighbor? Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
You got a pretty smile.
You got a pretty smile.
You ought to use it sometime. Here's another problem. Grinding. Teeth grinding. You sleep at night. And you're on edge about something. You're anxious about something. And in the night, your teeth are grinding. Sounds like a sawmill. And you're wearing your teeth away. Or maybe you have an overbite. Or maybe you have teeth that aren't growing in correctly. I've got 18 scriptures to remedy all of that. Well, the Lord does. So we're going to get in. Do you want to hear these verses? Or we can just sing Kumbaya. Come by here, Lord. All right. Let's get into this. Number one, Genesis 49, 10 through 12. You don't have to turn to all these. I'll read them out loud. There's so many. And plus, you're being filmed, so if you want the link, we'll get it to you. The scepter or leadership shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until Shiloh, the Messiah, the peaceful one, comes to whom it belongs. And to him shall be the obedience of the people. Binding his foal to the vine and his donkey's colt to the choice vine, he washes his garments in wine and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes are darker and more sparkling than wine. And his teeth are whiter than milk. Why would the Bible make a point to say your teeth are whiter than milk? Because it's healthy. Jesus' teeth are whiter than milk. Are you in the body of Christ? Then you have a right to have white teeth all the days of your life. Anybody want white teeth? I do. If you do public speaking at all, you want your teeth white. You want things right. So you can believe God for white teeth. There's a scripture to stand on. Number two, Job 19 and 20. My bone clings to my skin and to my flesh, and I've escaped with the skins or gums of my teeth. This person left town in a hurry. They escaped only with the skin on their body and the gums of their teeth. God can keep your gums. You've got roots going all crazy places. You know, you have wisdom teeth coming in. How many have wisdom teeth coming in? Anybody have wisdom teeth yet?
I got mine full.
There's four wisdom teeth. I only ever had two. One up here and one here. The other two didn't come in. And God brought both of these in straight so I didn't have to have them removed. That I have no issues with them whatsoever. I mean, God is so merciful in my life. So merciful. We'll get into wisdom teeth in a minute. But claim this. My teeth and my gum are kept intact by the power of God. You can have what you say. Number three, Job 29:17, and I broke the jaws or the big teeth of the unrighteous and plucked the prey out of his teeth. Some of you have been caught by the snare of the devil, and you're in his teeth, and you need him to break your enemy's teeth. Because he's grabbed hold of your heart with a lot of junk. And he's made God less than the best in your life. He's made you disinterested in the things of God, and he's got you right where he wants you. And so when you can least afford it, when you least expect it, he's going to eat your lunch, and you're the lunch. The Bible says he walks about as a roaring lion, seeking God. whom he may devour. That don't mean he is a lion, and it definitely doesn't mean he has to devour you. But if you aren't walking like you need to be walking, nobody said perfect, but just walk in the light of the word that you do have. Do what you do know to do, and you won't be food for the enemy. God will snatch you out of the teeth of the enemy. He will literally break the teeth of your enemies. People talk about you. People lie about you. God will have, he'll have a way to just snatch some teeth right out of people's mouth and make them a toothless wonder like they're trying to gum on you or something. Yeah, there's your scriptures. He says it again in Psalm 3 and 7. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you have struck all my enemies on the cheek. You have broken the teeth of the ungodly. Are you living ungodly? Is that what's going on? If you live ungodly, guess what happens? Teeth get broken. So how do you get out of living an ungodly life? You just repent. You just say, Lord, turn this for me. Turn my teeth that were broken into something powerful, into something awesome. Restore to me the years my teeth were stolen from me. And the minute you start to do that, you release something divine into the spirit, into the supernatural, and God comes forth. He says it again in Job 4 and 10. The roaring of the lion and the voice of the fierce lion and the teeth of the young lions are broken. So it doesn't just, this is just not for old fogies, old people. This is for young people. If young people don't act right, guess what happens? Teeth get broken. You ever seen people in a fight and somebody get busted in the mouth? This stuff applies. You start claiming these scriptures, you won't be on the recipient end of somebody's five-finger discount popping you upside the head. The word will save your teeth. I'm going to say it again. The word will save your teeth. Job 41 and 14. Who can open the doors of his lipless mouth? His extended jaws and bare teeth are terrible round about. God loves you at least as much as this beast to make your teeth perfectly round about. Some people have things growing left, growing right, not growing at all, growing abnormally, and they get braces. God's better than braces. Last time I checked, braces was several thousand dollars and several years in working its effects out. Bloody lips. God don't have a boyfriend or girlfriend with braces too. Y'all kiss, y'all might never come apart. Be hooked up from the teeth in. But with God, he can straighten things up. You can start claiming straight teeth right now. Preventative medicine is so much less expensive than actual surgery. It's easier to train young men than to repair grown adults and young women as well. The same is true of your teeth. Psalm 124 and 6, blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. There's another protective verse. Number 7, Proverbs 10, 26, as vinegar to the teeth and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to those who employ and send him. And I looked this up, vinegar to the teeth. You know, most of these sports drinks, most of these Coca-Cola drinks, I can say Coke now, I don't have to say pop. Up north, they say pop. I'm like, what? You know, we say Coke. You know, and they bring me a Coke. No, I wanted a Pepsi. Well, you said Coke. You don't get it, do you? It's all Coke. And I tell you which one kind of Coke I want. But they strip the acid, the vinegar, in those drinks strips the enamel off your teeth. It does. It's citric does it. Strips the enamel. And why does that matter? The enamel is what is the protective coating over your teeth. Once the enamel's gone, your teeth are just going to turn to like powder. And you'll just be gumming people. The toothless wonder. So you have a right to claim immunity to vinegar on your teeth. And it will actually change the diet. It will change the way you consume things. Steve said to me one time about 5 or 6 years ago, he said, man, I'm going to the store, you want anything? Man, I want an orange soda, a 2 liter of orange. And I know God was dealing with him because I know he's dealing with me. And he brought it to the door. He dropped off the 2 liter at my house. And he said, why don't you just let this be the last 2 liter you drink ever? And man, the Holy Ghost was all those on those words. And God is my living witness. I didn't even drink that 2 liter. And in 5 or 6 years, I've lost track of how many. I haven't had one single Coca-Cola. And I won't. I have no desire for it. I'm not tempted by it. God did a work in me. It's affecting me. It took me about another year or so to get off a Diet Coke, which is even worse. And so I can say in the last 4 or 5 years, I've had no soft drink beverages whatsoever. Ever, never. If I was a kid starting off like that, that'd be different. As an adult, when you've done it your whole life, that's a major move of God. You think that helped the enamel on my teeth? Oh, I know it did. So, you just start quoting the word, and the word will empower you to come off of things. How many of you smoke?
Can you stop?
Anybody smoke? You can claim immunity to even the desire with these verses, because that affects teeth. Sweet tea, same thing. I had the coffee, same thing. Man, I started getting up to Iowa, and Christians drink coffee like intravenously. And I looked at my teeth one day in the mirror. I said, Lord, look at that. I look like George Washington. With some old wooden teeth in there. He said, you got to come back off of that caffeine. You got to come back off of that coffee. And then I got baking soda, and I started just taking a bath in baking soda and claiming these verses. I'm getting my stuff back. Absolutely. All right. Proverbs 30 and 14. There is a class of people whose teeth are as swords and whose fangs as knives to devour the poor from the earth and the needy from among men. Don't let that be you. Don't be someone who breathes out cursings and anger. It will affect your mouth. You cause your teeth to fall out. Old potty mouth soul. Don't be this person. And if there's people like that in your life, cut them off with a samurai sword quickness. Don't let people devour you with their nasty old mouth. And then this is like a smooth sale. They're like snake oil salesmen. They want to gossip in your ear. They want to talk. Tell them, just say, put up a sign, say, do I need to wear a t-shirt that says, my ear is not a trash can? And cut them off. Because what happens is they're depositing poison in your spirit. And it might not come out right away, but believe me, it's coming. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And we're going to get to a scripture in a minute that says, confidence in an unfaithful man is like a broken tooth. If you're unfaithful with the words going into your heart, it'll cause your teeth to break off. That's why I'm so quick. If the Lord told me to tell a grandmother she's in sin, dying, going to hell, I don't care if she's 98 years old, I'll walk over there and tell her. I don't want my teeth falling out because I'm an unfaithful messenger. I like my teeth better than I care about hurting her feelings. It hadn't happened yet. But you know, I'm ready. It might be to tell somebody you love them, you care about them. You want your teeth falling off? You can't say that. You need to get over yourself. You need to get over your pride. You need to humble yourself and start saying what the word says, saying what your heart says. Your teeth will fall out, I'm telling you. Might not be today, might not be tomorrow. But, oh, what's that? I heard a weakening. I heard a loosening. And there ain't going to be no tooth fairy for this one. It's going to be costing more than a quarter to get that fixed. So be faithful to speak what the Lord says to speak. You keep your teeth. Ecclesiastes 12 and 3. In the day the keepers of the house tremble, the strong men bow themselves, and the grinders of the molar teeth cease because they are few, and those who look out the windows' eyes are darkened. God cares about your molars. God cares about your wisdom teeth. He'll do you like he did mine. He'll cause them to not come in at all or to come in completely straight. Or if they came in crooked, he can fix them in your sleep. You can wake up, you can go to bed with fanged teeth, wake up in the morning looking like $1 million. If you can believe it, if you can trust it. You can have it. You need fillings? He can plop gold fillings in your teeth. We started preaching a message called Gemstones. Yeah, I got a few phone calls and letters on that one. But you know what? People started seeing gold dust on them in praise and worship. Diamond rings start showing up in the offering plate. A wedding band showed up in the offering plate. People finding crystals all over the place. And some of them were too afraid to testify, and I know they had things happen. And I'm having to pull it out of them. They don't want to go on camera as a confirmation. So I know gemstones works. I know spare body parts works. And I know this teeth message is working. And he told me today, if you'll preach this, I'm going to anoint it, and I'm going to do super miraculous things in their teeth if they'll let me. It might be instantaneous, or it might be spontaneous, or it might be progressive. It might be supernatural and spectacular, or it might be natural. Here's a dentist and money you didn't have. It could be, I'm not putting a limit on him. I'm releasing the word and let the word work. And if you have family that need this, be the conduit. Walk up to them and just, boom, be healed in Jesus' name. Who's next? Boom, be healed in Jesus' name. I know you got somebody that needs it. All right. Song of Solomon 4:2. Your teeth are like a flock of shorn ewes which have come up from the washing, of which all are in pairs and none is missing among them. That's a good scripture to claim for your teeth. Grandma? Grandma? All your teeth are kept. What? Yeah, I got Bible for it. Aren't grandmas sweet? They got nice smiles. And then sometimes, man, look at all that in there. Too much junk in the trunk. Let's fix that. Here's your verses. Go sit with grandma. Have a Bible study with grandma around these verses. It's on Facebook. It could be posted. I actually already did. And this link. Number 11. Song of Solomon 6:6. Your teeth are like a flock of ewes coming from their washing. Oh, we just read that. But it applies still. No disease in your teeth. Gingivitis. Anybody brush your teeth and your mouth bleeds? Raise your hand. You brush your teeth and your mouth bleeds. Anybody? There you go. Gingivitis. There's your verse. My teeth are like lambs coming from their washing. They're all in pairs, and not one of them is missing. I've got healthy gums. I've got healthy teeth. I've got no gingivitis. You do the dental floss. Dude, there it goes, like a bloody river. You look like Rocky Balboa, spitting blood in the sink, like you've been boxing somebody. Gingivitis. Number 12, Isaiah 41:15. Behold, I will make you to be a sharp threshing instrument which has teeth. You shall thresh the mountains and beat them small and make the hills like chaff. If you've lost teeth, this is your verse to claim new teeth. I want to back up to enamel for a minute. I want to back up to missing teeth for a minute. The Holy Ghost had me read about the teeth itself and the cavity in the enamel, particularly the enamel and the tooth itself. In the enamel, there's no living cells. In the teeth, there's no living cells. So they can't regenerate. Do you understand how crucial it is to have healthy teeth? They don't grow back. There's no way naturally for them to grow back. You know, it's not like you cut yourself and it scabs over and then the skin comes back. When your teeth are gone, in the natural, they're gone. And that's why you have to go see somebody about it. We've been preaching resurrection. We've had kidneys restart. Kidneys resurrected. That this doesn't happen. Well, I believe that God can do an even greater miracle in a part of your body that's dead, no life in it. Not resurrect it, but cause it to come to life and grow to begin with. Why? Because he's God and can do whatever he wants to do, if people will let him. So you've got holes in your teeth, just start claiming teeth to grow. Grow teeth in the name of Jesus. We have legs grow, arms grow. Just tell your teeth to grow. Romans 10:17. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word. Just make sure you get complete faith. You don't have a tooth growing. Get your whole tooth growing. I know it sounds crazy to the natural mind, but I'm telling you, this is good stuff. This is what you stand on faith for and believe for supernatural things to happen. You trust them with your teeth, you can trust them with anything. Here's one that he really spoke hard to me for you guys about. Almost to the end. Jeremiah 31:29. In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. Raise your hand. How many of you went to bed last night stressed over something going on in your home or your family? Raise your hand high. You went to bed last night, somebody was fighting, somebody was arguing, somebody was missing, somebody was drunk, somebody was high.
Arguing.
Went to bed last night in some kind of way because of something that was going on. Raise your hand high. Don't be bashful. One. Two. We got two honest people in the whole room. Who went to bed last night some kind of negative way because of something going on in the home? Restriction, friction, fussing, fighting, arguing. Somebody's missing. Somebody's gone. Raise your hand high.
Only last night?
I'm just starting with last night. We're going to go back in the past. All right. So you know what it's like to have your teeth set on edge. You go to bed and you're just like bracing yourself for the next crazy thing to happen. It used to be that way in my home. Man, Christmas came around and I'd be hiding my little sister behind me to protect her from people and my dad and my brothers in fist fights. Multiple years I remember that. You go to bed with your teeth on edge that night, not knowing what's going on. Holes in the wall, the smell of alcohol all the way down the trailer, no wider than that pole to that wall right there. Smoking, drinking, they pass out, catch a place on fire, and you and your sister burn up. That'll cause your teeth to set on edge. You come home, nobody's home, 3 or 4 days in a row, you don't know where they are. Somebody sneak in, just cut your head off. That'll cause you to go to sleep like this. One foot in the floor, one eye open. That affects your teeth. That stresses your mouth, stresses your teeth, stresses your heart. You don't have to have that because of your parents' sins. You don't have to have that because of your sins. That's your scripture to claim right there. I will not go to bed with my teeth on edge ever again the rest of my life. They might be shooting each other in the hallway. But you've got the peace of God in your heart. You've got the protection of God all around you. They might be knifing outside your window, and you just sleep like a baby. Because of the Word of God. See, the Bible works if you work it. The Bible's relevant if you believe it. Number 14, Daniel 7 and 5. And behold, another beast, the second one, was like a bear, raised itself up on its side. Three ribs were in its mouth between its teeth. And it was told, arise and devour much flesh. Maybe your teeth are fine. But you feel, we had a fella, I've had this happen twice in the last 60 days. I've had two different people call me and say, Pastor, I need your help. We were in our house, we were in our home, and all of a sudden, my wife or my sister felt something bite her in the back. They've got teeth mark on their back. There was nobody there. And some invisible force bit them on the back. And there's proof. I've got actual teeth marks on the back. Some of y'all got demons in your homes you don't even know. You all cuddle up with them. And when you least expect it, boom, snatch you just like that. The exorcist ain't got nothing. Your head be spinning around, pea soup coming out. So maybe your teeth are fine. But it's the teeth in the room that's after your behind. And you need to do something with it. Am I right? Mm-hmm. Isn't that word sublime? Come on now, I'm not trying to rhyme every time. I thought we had gospel rappers in here. Maybe I missed something. All right. Number 15, Amos 4 and 6. I also gave you cleanness of teeth in your cities and want of bread. That's because you got no food to eat. Your teeth are clean because you got no food. You can't have a cavity if you're not eating food. God don't want it to be that way in your life. So God wants to supernaturally stock your fridge tonight, if you'll let him, if you'll allow him. There's no sense in having clean teeth because you got no food. Man, we're going to pray in a minute, and the fire station is going to come down here and start hosing the building down. Fire shooting off the roof. Zechariah 9 and 7, we got three to go and we're done. And I will take out of the Philistines' mouths and between their teeth the abominable idolatrous sacrifices eaten with the blood. Some of y'all eat stuff I wouldn't feed my dog. Some of y'all wake up. I pastor about 5 churches right now and mentor some more. And I see these single moms. I know they're working hard. I know they're struggling. And I see their kids coming in with breakfast. You know what they got for breakfast? Skittles. You know what they have for lunch? A cookie. And then the children look like little Chucky and Freddy Krueger and Jason running around the room. And I just want to give them corporal punishment. I want to hang them up and just beat them like a pinata bag. And it's not that. It's they're so sugared up. They're so high. Spanking would only accelerate the problem. They come off the spanking going, wow, hit me again. You need to get the idols out of your life. Food should not be a temple you bow down to. You should not be chained to the refrigerator. Listen, he dealt with me recently about this. He said, son, I got a little drunk in the Holy Ghost. I tied one or two on. I passed out. I woke up and my church was gone. I was in the floor with my finger in a hole in the floor. And my hand looked like it had been bleeding. And I was alone in the dark. Or so I thought. And then an angel picked me up off the floor and walked me through the church back to my home, and I got or to my room back in the church, and I walked by the refrigerator. He said, oh, and by the way, you're not chained to this refrigerator. Every time you have stress, you have enormous stress, and every time you feel that, it's like you just run to the refrigerator to eat. Why? Because you're trying to get a good feeling instead of dealing with the stress, instead of cutting crazy people out of your inner ears. And distancing yourself from problems, you're tied to the fridge. That's idolatry. That's a sin. That's making food your God. God's your source, not bananas, not cookies, not ice cream, magic shell ice cream, and 14 peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. God is your source. These verses will cut idolatry out of your life. You shouldn't be drinking a 6-pack a day of anything except water. Okay, I'm going to move on for you. Y'all start throwing stuff at me. All right. Number 17. Matthew 13 to 42. We got one more to go. And we'll cast him in the furnace of fire. There will be weeping and wailing and grinding of teeth. Sin in your life will ruin your mouth. There's just no other way to say it. And some of your parents are causing you to go through the fire. And it shouldn't be so. So we're going to break the power of the devil off of some of your parents' lives so it's not trickling down into your life. It's hard to eat right when you got no money and your parents don't either. They're supposed to be providing for you, not the other way around. That's what the Bible says. A godly father provides for his kids. Some of you might not even know what that looks like. I understand. But we can change that tonight. Psalms 27 and 10 says, when my mother and my father forsake me, not if, when. And sometimes they don't forsake you like intentionally. They just die and they're gone. The Bible says, then the Lord will take me up. Somebody needs to be claiming that right now. God is my father. God is my mother. I have one parent alive, no grandparents and no father. I've got one. And don't you know I'm laying hands on that woman next time I see her, speaking long life over her, little 5'5" head. I need her around. But you know what? God has had to stand in the gap for me. My dad died in 1999. I was 29 years old, and I didn't know him that well when he was alive. Some of you need to be claiming these verses. Psalm 68:6, he sets the solitary in families. That's what he did for you today. You could have been anywhere, and you're here. God's setting you in a family. Look around, look left, look right. Say, what's up, brother? What's up, sister? What's up, mom? What's up, dad? Welcome to the fam. Do it. Look around. Say, welcome to the family.
Welcome to the hood.
I would take you to the res. Say, welcome to the res, friend. Number 18, Proverbs 25:19. We'll wrap it up with this. Confidence in an unfaithful man in a time of trouble is like a broken tooth. Or a foot out of joint. Say what God tells you to say. If he tells you to pray for somebody in here, you better walk your behind over there and pray for them, or your tooth will start falling out. You can quote me on it. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow. But you don't use your teeth to do what God said to do. You don't sanctify your teeth then his anointing is not obligated to cover your teeth. You're stepping outside of the realm of his protection. If you won't use everything he gave you to glorify him, it's suspect to evil and disease. Some find that out sooner rather than later. Some find out the easy way. They read it in the Bible and they do it. They went to the school of wisdom, tuition's free. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Some people, knucklehead, hardhead, won't listen. They're going to the school of experience where the tuition is costly and sometimes more than you can pay or ever repay. So let's pray. If you're in here today and you would say, Pastor, and those 18 verses and those 10 different instances, I'm in there. I need a new tooth. I need a filling. I need my breath to not be bad. I need gingivitis gone. I need teeth to grow. I've got a relative. Just simply raise your hand. Just by show of hands, if that's you, raise it high so I can see it. I just want to pray for you. One, two, three. Anybody else? All right. Let's do this. You three, I want you to gather in a circle right there. Just gather in a circle. I want you to start laying hands on each other. Releasing faith for one another's needs to be met in this area.
Why is it the leaders only got two fishers?
Y'all teeth good? Oh, we're getting to them next.
Y'all old heads, that's why. They're all perfect. You see that? Hold up, wait for it.
Vonnie just needed to come here. She get an understanding of what all that meant.
Yeah.
You guys are anointed and appointed to minister to one another's needs. Now we're going to take care of them. All right, now let's just get brutally honest. You guys start praying. Start praying. Let's get brutally honest. When your grandmother smiles, you love her. But dude, there's some work that needs to go on in her smile. Her teeth are not right. Or you got an uncle. You got a mom. You got a dad. You got a brother. Oh, you got an uncle. You got an uncle. Who's got an uncle?
I got an uncle, boy.
You got an uncle. Two, that's right. The Holy Ghost is dancing. I mean, he's, whoa, we need to get, what's his name? What's his name? Uncle Fred. We need to get Uncle Fred a tooth. More than a tooth.
Ain't your uncle dead?
I want you to go stand right there in the corner.
And it's on your uncle Fred. Stand, and please, Fred.
No, that's my brother.
Go stand right there in the corner. We're going to minister to you. In proximity for your uncle.
No, is he probably don't know. He like his teeth.
just stand right there. Just stand right there. No, we're going to pray for him right now. Through you. Through you. All right, stand right there. Stand right there.
He's clean, though.
He's not going to pray for him.
All right, Steve's going to pray for your uncle as if you were your uncle, okay? And God's going to release a miracle in your uncle's life. Going to release. All right, who is it that brushes your teeth or does, what's that, and the blood runs out? Floss or brush, and you got blood running out? Raise your hand. Who is that? Is that you? You know somebody that happens there?
No, it did it before.
It did it before? Okay, well, you know what to do now if it comes back. All right. Who in here's parents have some kind of heart disease? Or they had a stroke? Anybody? Heart disease or a stroke? They're paralyzed in some way. All right, that's fine, good. Who in here has nasty eating habits? Just be honest, you know you do. You're a sugarholic. Okay, I want you to go stand right there.
What you mean, like you eat too much?
You got your diet's not like it is. Now, Rebecca is going to come minister to all y'all. She's going to lay hands on you and pray idols and bad eating and bad stuff out of your lives. And when you guys finish, please help Rebecca. There's a whole line right there. They got jacked up eating things going on. They need right eating habits. Idols removed.
Right eating habits?
Right eating habits. Idols of food removed. They bow down to food. They don't eat right. Sugarholics. All right. You guys need anything along these lines? Know anybody who does need anything along these lines? All right. And what I want you to do is just start praising the Lord for what God's doing in their lives. Can you do that? And it's so simple. This is what it sounds like. Jesus, thank you for answering their prayers. That's a praise. Can you do that? Can you say, Jesus, thank you for answering their prayers? Yeah. That's all I want you to do. Thank you.
McDonald's is so bad for you. So bad.
Me talking about sugar? What are you talking about, Pastor? Some sugar.
You didn't have it, sugar, or anything.
I eat red lobster.
It's bad. Y'all need to watch that documentary, Food Inc. Y'all won't have the hamburger again.
I've seen it there.
Be sure to check these out.